Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming to my talk. I know it's just between, I'm between you and the pub crawl, so I'll try to make it count and keep you awake. So I'm here to talk about availability, the new kind of inventor's dilemma. I am the manager of performance and reliability at Netflix. A little bit about me. So the organization I manage at performance, at Netflix on performance and reliability has a number of different dimensions. You might have seen some of the presentations that involve Chaos Monkey or Chaos Kong. That's managed by one of my teams. We also focus on reducing our time to detect and time to resolve, so getting better alerting capabilities in the hands of teams, and that can be based off Atlas, a solution I'll talk about in a second, or it can be based on other capabilities, but we really try to reduce the time it takes to determine when something is wrong with the service. I also handle cloud capacity planning. We have a very large cloud footprint, and so that's a pretty exciting part of my job. The chaos team also handles traffic management. So when we do these exercises where we fail traffic from one region to another, that steering is done through a utility that the team maintains. We inject chaos. We build a lot of performance tooling for the engineering teams. We're at a pretty big scale, and we tend to break a lot of commercial tools, and we really only need a subset of functionality. So I have a performance team. Brendan Gregg's on there. He presented here last year. And then we drive operational best practices. So our organization, I would say we don't own availability and performance, but we're in charge of making sure that over time, those dimensions improve for Netflix overall. Netflix, you guys have heard of us before, most likely. Anybody use Netflix? Anyone? Excellent. Does anybody like any of the originals? Because say any of them, because it's mixed, right? You have to find the one you like. We're cruising towards 70 million subscribers. I think we're closer to 60 countries now, and we continue to add more. We launched Japan a few weeks ago. We're launching Italy, Spain, and Portugal in a couple weeks. So we're going to continue to grow across the globe. We're about 36% of the internet traffic at night in the United States. I've heard we've passed porn, but something to be proud of. But we consume a lot of bandwidth in the US every night. We have a massive cloud footprint. So when I talk about massive in general terms, it's somewhere between 50 and 100,000 instances running across three regions. That's like the range I can give you. And sometimes there's a misperception that we actually serve our assets for video off the cloud. We don't. We have our own homegrown CDNs. We have an Open Connect framework. It's based on FreeBSD and Nginx. And we basically build it and give it away to ISPs and other people that want to have it embedded. And that's we place those all around the globe. So the cloud is where all of your devices talk to, say, get a license, update your bookmark history, add titles, select one to play. It's still, I think of that 36% of traffic, it's somewhere in the ballpark of maybe 10 or 15% of that. And our originals, yay. I can't even fit them all on the screen anymore. Our open source offering is something we're quite proud of. When I talk about getting to the cloud, we feel like as we went along the way, we started developing the solutions as a platform. And by open sourcing them and sharing them, we got some really great feedback. And at the same time, we also enabled others to get on the cloud as well, which is important for us, right? It's sort of putting your bets on what you think is the winning horse, and I consider Amazon the winning horse. Atlas is our open source monitoring solution. So it, I think it has a little over 2 billion time series per minute which come in and get aggregated, and then it exposes performance data to most engineers with a 99th percentile response time of like 3 seconds. Dynamite is a replicated layer built on top of Redis, so if you want to use Redis, but run it in AWS. And for both Dynamite and EVCache is memcache, but we built extensions on top of it so you could replicate data automatically from the client library between availability zones. So that's a common pattern we've had where there might be an existing solution that we want to leverage, and then we say, well, how do we AWS-ify this, right? Or how do we make this more reliable? Asgard, that was initially our, I would say it was in place of the Amazon Web Console for us because we had a lot of behaviors that weren't supported initially. We announced that we're going to be, we're planning to open source a new solution called Spinnaker. And so Spinnaker is like Asgard on steroids with a whole bunch of other stuff, like continuous delivery, integrated canary analysis. Expect in the next quarter or so to be a lot more information about Spinnaker coming out, which is our new continuous delivery platform. Vector I had to put up here, not just because the logo is awesome, but my performance team created on-host high-resolution monitoring framework, so any engineer can point at an instance and see real high-resolution telemetry. And then Hystrix, I'll cover that later. That's how we insulate microservices from each other when failures occur and have things happen automatically. So this is probably one of about 40 open source projects we have. I'm probably wrong on that, but I suggest if you're going to jump into Amazon, if you haven't already and you're looking for some sort of platform, performance, other component, check out what we have on the site, and I put the link in here for reference. Today I'm going to talk about two primary things. I'm going to talk about how Netflix as a company maximizes engineering velocity and how we get stuff to the cloud. And then I'm going to talk about how my organization, working with other engineering teams, makes sure that Netflix stays up and running. We have a pretty high availability goal, and we try to keep that out of the way of, we don't like to slow people down. But when you think about Netflix, we have three priorities, really, engineering-wise, or as a business. We have innovation, reliability, and efficiency. And so efficiency isn't the top, but I'll talk about that. When I first did a walkthrough for this presentation, I became aware that if you just jump into like where we are as Netflix and you're talking to people who might be thinking about moving to the cloud, it's a little bit daunting, right? It might sound like we were born as a fully mature adult, like we just popped out on the cloud and we're like running around and everything's awesome. It was a journey for us as well, right? So I stole this from Ralph Waldo Emerson. It's usually life is a journey. But I want to talk to you a bit about, before we get into the innovation and availability part, about how we got to where we are as a company. So in 2008, we were primarily DVDs only. And we're running out of one data center, and we had a failure. And that data center was offline for a couple days, I think. It was it's a big bummer. You know, good thing is you had a DVD sitting in your house, and you could watch it, or you're forced to watch it if you hadn't watched it up till then. The downside is that we didn't have a alternate strategy to serve our customers at that time, and we had to make some decisions. We had some fairly innovative people in the organization, Adrian Cockcroft being one of them, where we decided that instead of building another data center, we would go to the cloud. And we started talking to Amazon and partnering with them. So by 2010, we were actually serving a subset of our customer traffic out of AWS. We had started to build the tooling for that. We deployed across three availability zones. So we realized that ideally, you know, we would have had that level of redundancy in the data center, but we decided to have that when we moved into Amazon from day one, and we built that into the platform such that if one data center failed, the other two could support the existing traffic. Then we went across the pond and we went to Europe. And so one of the luxuries for us at that point in time is we didn't have to build a data center, right? We could basically just take our existing machine images, solve some functional problems we had around licensing and content, and just stand up the same stack over in EU, right? And that gives us great flexibility as a business. You know, we're not necessarily sure what markets are always going to be the best markets for us. There's a lot of people that want to sell you streaming content. Having the flexibility to move where our business has its highest population is great, and the cloud does that. Chaos Monkey was born that year. We were noticing that since we were moving to stateless services, we needed to really have a way to enforce that when something dies, everything continues working. So we wrote Chaos Monkey, and we start going around shooting instances. I think everybody's heard about Chaos Monkey. It just terminates instances in a controlled fashion. We have had some issues in the past, but he's under control now. put him back in the cage every now and then. And then in 2012, there's something you don't see in the timeline here. Around Christmas Eve of 2012, we had a pretty bad outage in one of our regions. And even though our infrastructure was healthy, we were unable to get customers back to it. So again, we sort of went back to the drawing board and said, we do all these things to make ourselves highly available. How do we actually solve for that scenario? And the decision was made, what we're going to do is take our stack that's in US East 1 and replicate it to US West 2. We put in mechanisms where we replicate Memcache data using SQS at the time. Now we're using Kafka. And we actually chose to run active-active. So this is no different from a decision for your business if you want to run to be highly available. I have a data center. I run with another one. I don't know if anybody's had this experience where you run in an active-passive model and you're shipping backups to the other site. And unfortunately, when you actually restore the backup, something doesn't work. common risk. I was a DBA for a while. So we decided to run active-active. So actually today, we run about 45% of our traffic in the Americas out of PDX or US West 2. And then we run the other 50 or so percent out of US East 1 in an active way. And I'll talk about how we get code out there. And so we had the monkey to kill things at a local level, like within a region. And we decided, well, we need to exercise this muscle or flex this muscle to make sure when we have to make that call, we can fail over. And we created Chaos Kong. And if you stop by the booth, you'll see a visualization of a simulation of traffic failover between the regions. And Chaos Kong is the overarching term for that. And we have an application called Flow that actually handles all of the rerouting and DNS management. And then this year, great news, we're actually getting our last application to the cloud out of the data center. And when you think about it, as far back as 2010, we were developing every new service in the cloud just by default. Like, I have a new service, it's a geo service or something, it goes right in the cloud, no questions, nothing's going back in the data center. But sometimes you have various legacy applications. Maybe you have something that has dependencies to payment providers, right? And there's some certain level of infrastructure. So we've actually moved out to the cloud this year, which is great. I liked seeing the all-in slide today in the keynote, and Netflix was right up there. We've been all-in for a while. All services go into Netflix if they're new. And now we're all-in. We're getting everything out of the data center, which is great. And then this holiday season, we're actually going to be running active, I guess, in three regions. So across US West 2, US East 1, and EU West, we're going to have the capability to very flexibly steer traffic in the event of a failover. And we're looking forward to exercising that. It drives a lot of our capacity decisions. Okay, so it didn't happen overnight. Out of the way. Innovator's dilemma. When I think about a lot of decisions companies have to make about going the DevOps route, I think the positives of being in a DevOps environment and enabling your users to, you know, own what they run is amazing, right? We've all seen even small projects get off the ground where people can innovate so quickly. It feels like running with scissors if you just think about the bad parts of it, right? Like, I'm just going to give all these people access to push code every day to my production infrastructure, and we're going to be down all the time. But if I don't do that, I'm not going to compete effectively against the people in my space, right? And the alternate you think of is a rock. Like, I am just not going to change anything. I'm going to keep the lights on. And maybe you have enough of a market share that you can just sit and get the maintenance revenue for a while. But in general, we found that running with scissors was a better strategy for us. There's the, you know, the age-old, not age-old, probably decades-old idea of as you increase your rate of change in your environment, your availability or your reliability will decrease, right? We've all experienced this. Like, people are pushing code, they push it faster. Maybe the process doesn't evolve to be more resilient, and your availability actually degrades over time. The organization I'm in, operations engineering, believes that we can both accelerate the velocity of development while also improving our availability. And we've proven it out. It's actually worked out quite well, and I'm going to go through those strategies. But it's based on this fundamental belief that we can do that. So first, I'm going to talk about how we optimize velocity so our developers can get code out there quickly. I love this picture of breaking the sound barrier, and I thought that was pretty innovative when they did that. That had to be pretty scary, right? Like, being able to get up to, what is it, Mach 1 and actually have all these strange behaviors happen on your plane. And I read up on Chuck Yeager, who 2 days before the flight actually broke a rib, and he was so scared he was gonna miss the mission, he went to a veterinarian and got repaired. And he didn't tell anybody but his wife and his co-pilot or whatever, the guy who was on the program. I don't think that we were like flying a plane and not knowing if it was going to disintegrate, but I would say the decision of us at the time to go into the cloud was a very risky decision, right? It was something we were betting the business on, but we did it in a smart manner. I don't think that risk exists today. Like, if I was starting a startup tomorrow, I would just go straight into the cloud, right? I wouldn't even think about putting stuff in a data center. So the first step, and I have three steps to maximizing the engineering velocity at Netflix. One is give them infrastructure on demand. In other words, give them a big button, and every time they have an idea or they have some code they've created and they want to drop it into production, just give them a button they can mash. And it's like, okay, all of this capacity drops out of a big funnel. I don't know if people have gone through procurement processes. Like, I need a server. Okay, you fill it out, you get the PO, it shows up maybe in a few weeks. Then I need to get it racked and stacked, and then I have to have somebody lay down the OS image and put the security policies on it, and invariably something gets missed. So that all boils down to minutes. And for those of you on the cloud, you've probably experienced this. We also run in a unique model to maximize velocity where we're in one prod account for all engineering teams. And that's why I say there's no procurement process. It's one account. All of our guarantees are there. All you can eat, right? You want 1,000 instances? This box right here on Spinnaker, you can just type in 1,000 instances right now. I could do it right here, and suddenly I have 1,000 of something running somewhere, right? But we don't want you to eat all of it. We have had cases where maybe somebody's deployed too much, but in general, people get used to it over time, and we put tooling in place to minimize that. Another benefit for us is every time we have a need for some sort of middleware, like let's say we need a messaging service, you know, SQS is there. It's just available. We plug it into our platform code, and it's available. We don't have to build it out. All of these services are available to our engineers internally through Spinnaker. I will point out that giving people the ability to eat what they want and just deploy in general, we manage capacity behind the scenes, and I'm not here to talk about that today, but in general, we rely very heavily on the on-demand pool every month. We assume that if anybody needs to do a push and we don't have enough reservations, they're just going to get the capacity, a luxury that we didn't have in the data center. I talked about Spinnaker a little bit, but when you think about the steps required to get your code into the cloud and running up on an auto-scaling group, I write my code, I check it in, I build it in Jenkins, I do functional tests, and then I have to bake it, right? I have to bake an Amazon machine image, I have to register that in the region so it's available for me to create an auto-scaling group out of, and then what I'm gonna do is I wanna deploy a canary, and I wanna run that canary in production to see if there are characteristics of it that differ from the baseline and it's not a safe push. Passes canary analysis, then I'm gonna push, and I'm say, okay, this code needs to go to US East 1 now because it's off peak. And then, now that it's passed its test, when EU West 1 is off peak, I'll push the code there, and we have a red-black push model. But this can be done in minutes, and because all those buttons that used to have to be strung together, I would say for a number of years, we didn't have seamless integration from end to end, so you'd have to wait for your espresso after spending hours doing this stuff, and hopefully not making any mistakes. And now it's a button, right? You construct your build pipeline, you set up your canary analysis phase, bam, your code goes out. And I'll talk about those steps in detail. But we also don't want our engineers to have to worry about, what's the trap, you know, what's the off-peak period right now in EU? And have 40 teams know when to do the push at the right time. We give them templates so we know when the best time is for them to push. And most code isn't so critical, it has to go out right now, right? It's okay if it goes out in the middle of the night. The last aspect of accelerating engineering velocity is to have a microservice architecture. I think someone wrote up that this is one of the most frequently Googled words today is microservices. I was lucky enough to come into Netflix after we were already on a microservice architecture. We have about 500 of them running in production. Some of them are super tiny, right? Like they give you a key. Some of them are much larger, like they pre-compute the row for you related to your interests on some genre. But the benefit for us of the microservice architecture is, and out the gate, one of the reasons we built Asgard was we wanted everybody to deploy inside of an auto-scaling group. Don't stand up your instances manually, put them in an ASG because it has a number of sort of self-healing properties, right? If an instance terminates, the control plane will add another one in there, right? You don't have to worry about, oh, I deployed five or five still running. We also decouple all of our teams in terms of a push schedule. So everybody writes their own service. They check their client library into Artifactory, and when I go to build my service, build it and then bake it, I just pick up their client library from Artifactory, I pin to some version, ideally release, and I pick up that piece of code and I run through my deployment process. But when you think about all of the services that are orchestrated together to make Netflix run, I only have to change the portion of the code that actually matters today, like, hey, we have a new rule. Example might be, we have a new rule about parental policies in the Netherlands, right? We have to put that in one service. I can just go change the one service that deals with parental policies. I don't have to go touch everything and risk pulling along all these commits and changes that have nothing to do with what I need out there today. I think the other fundamental aspect of the microservice architecture, which is just awesome, is you don't touch other people's data, right? You talk through APIs. If anybody's been at a company where you run on like a relational database, and you have multiple modules talking in there, like here's my schema, here's your schema. At some point, someone will say, I just need a little bit of your data, and they'll write a query against your table, like a symbolic link or something. At that point, they've created a tight coupling, and your ability to change your schema and how you run your service has been limited. And so at Netflix, we actually have 280 Cassandra clusters. Every service, like if I came up with a service today called Coburn, I'd go push a button, I'd get a Cassandra cluster, and it's mine. I define the schema, I maintain the rate of data change, I set the TTLs. But by isolating all of those, even though it introduces some level of inefficiency, because there's so many of them, it allows every team to move at the rate they want. And the thing I didn't put up here is you have to make sure that all of your API changes are backwards compatible, but that's just something people get in the habit of doing, right? Because there's so many versions of your client library running at a time. But the underlying message is you really want to minimize your aggregate, maybe not, you still want a lot of change, but you want to break it into small pieces and distribute it over time versus a big bang. My big monolithic app is going to go through QA, it's going to pass some tests, and then we're going to push it out, and then it's going to break, and we're going to roll it back. It's much better, I think, to have smaller amounts of functionality going out. So that's what I have for maximizing engineering velocity. Most people have probably applied a subset of these, maybe all of them in some cases, and some haven't yet applied them. So Mario Andretti said, if everything seems under control, you're not going fast enough. That feels like Netflix a lot of the time because it's like, whoa, this is a little bit wild, right? Are we going to do that? But we do it, and we do it because we know that it's important to get that capability out, but we also think about what the implications of it are. So I think of when we minimize the risks to availability, we don't ask 40 teams to solve them all individually. We think, how do we build a really good airbag system for Netflix such that everybody, regardless of how they drive their car, they drive really fast, they drive really slow, they're a little reckless, we're going to make sure that the end user doesn't suffer. So part one, make sure you're running on extremely durable infrastructure. So Amazon has worked out fantastically for us, right? I think S3 has like 11 nines of availability and 4 nines of durability, I apologize, Tim, if I got that wrong or the inverse, but it's just an incredible amount of availability on many of the services, which I don't think we could achieve that internally if I had someone running a SAN. Maybe I could, but I don't really want to. We purchase a lot of reserved instances, so given the size of our footprint, remember we have these 50 to 100,000 instances running out there. When I'm doing big swings for failover, or I'm actually standing up large auto-scaling peaks every day, I don't want to rely on the on-demand pool for that. If it means someone on Netflix can't stream because they can't get an instance, then that's a fault on my part for the purpose of like saving a few pennies here and there. So we actually purchase 3-year heavy reservations, which give us a great financial benefit. And even though I'm not talking about efficiency, we have other services that consume the unused capacity every day. So encoding will look out there and say, oh, you're not using these instances, and start kicking off some encoding jobs. But it helps us use up all that capacity. And then we follow our best practice of taking an auto-scaling group and putting it across 3 availability zones. There's other practices we put in place around IPC routing, but this is the big one, right? Lay yourself across multiple data centers or collections of data centers to maintain the right availability. Spinnaker, to go a little more detail into, I was talking about that big magic button. So it isn't a button that doesn't require configuration, but when you're thoughtful about it and you set it up to have a very effective pipeline and canary process, you can sleep at night. and if you don't, I mean, even like a month ago, someone hadn't adopted a pipeline, and I think it was 2 a.m. They decided to do a push, and it somehow messed something up. And so then it's a really easy use case to say, hey, let's help you get onto the build pipeline. And it was not a challenging discussion. Red-black pushes, some people call them blue-green. We've designed a model in such a way that, except for some of our infrastructure tiers like Cassandra or EV Cache, when we do an upgrade, well, when we deploy a new version of the code, we actually don't upgrade anything. We don't have like an Amazon machine image instance, running and apply some scripts that maybe change some of the bits and start and stop it. We stand up an entire new ASG, and that's what our Asgard tool did and now Spinnaker did, and it adds a new, it increments the suffix, so we have 2 versions of our code running in production, and then we roll our traffic over to the new one, and if there's a problem, we just roll it back immediately, right? We don't have to say, oh, let's go un-upgrade that server, which might be hours and a bunch of pain. So having this model where you're just, supplanting the previous version of code is very efficient. The build pipelines are something, it's pretty cool. We've introduced some new capabilities. You can have this red-black push. You might be a service that doesn't need to do a gradual traffic rollover. You might be pre-compute. For capacity purposes, you might just want to say, tear down the old one, stand up the new one, and that's called the Highlander, because there can be only one. I think our team has a lot of fun naming these pipeline strategies. And then we incorporate canary analysis into it. You can see in this build pipeline here, which runs every day, Sunday through Thursday, we don't do it on Friday, but it bakes the image, so it goes and finds the image. There's some parts in advance of this. but it actually runs a canary, and the canary failed, and as a result, the push didn't go out to the two regions. It stopped the pipeline. It was like a check. And the one below it, everything went smoothly, and the deployment went out. We also, one of the parts, letting people push code into production fast is great. Catching problems, the sooner they occur, the better. So even though we have canary analysis, sometimes things will sneak out, right? Sometimes under a certain level of scale, you'll have thread pools lock up. You'll have something go wrong. But detecting that in 30 seconds, it used to take us 5 to 7 minutes about 6 months ago to get an alert of a major event. And now we've got it down to 30 seconds, which saves us, you know, hundreds of thousands of streams a minute. So canary analysis. This is really the secret sauce of getting code safely into production. All the other stuff is great. It automates things. It avoids human error. Canary analysis is about running analytics on a set of metrics you select, which you consider important for your service. And so when a canary runs, the build pipeline will stand up a new version of your code, maybe like 4 instances. It'll stand up an old version of your code because we want them to have a similar lifetime given certain performance behaviors. And then it'll analyze those metrics for like an hour. Our Edge team, which is our largest service, it incorporates about 700 jars each day. They push every 24 hours on a schedule, and their canary analysis configuration is very complex. They have probably over 1,500 metrics, and you can weigh them such that certain groups of metrics are more important than others. And then when they're rolled up, they give you this aggregate score, and you define at what score you're comfortable pushing your code out. So in this case, it was marginal. I don't know if this push went out, but you can very quickly see why it failed, and it was something related to network. So they probably didn't push that one out. But it's really the gate for getting your code out in production. Resiliency. So you have all these teams developing a bunch of services. Having 40 teams do everything perfectly all the time operationally is a little bit of a stretch, right? And it's no fault on the teams. It's just running things can be operationally complex. Hystrix is a framework you can implement in your service. We have a Java version. A couple people have written some in some other languages. But it basically says, okay, I'm a service that gets a list of movies that I'm going to show you, like this one here. And when I say, give me the rows of movies for Coburn, you're going to give it back to me, and I'm going to start drawing it on the screen or hand it back to the UI. But let's say that the service, which is supposed to give me the list of movies, is having a problem. And I set up the thresholds that we analyze and generate recommendations for, which says, if I start getting timeouts from you or errors from you that span a certain rolling window, I'm basically going to stop talking to you. And it just opens the circuit, and it says, we're not talking anymore. You can only do that for some services, right? Like, you're not going to be able to play a movie if I don't give you a DRM license of some sort. But for, like, this type of data, I'm fine sort of clicking around and finding something to watch if there's a major problem going on. So that circuit will open, and then you have a fallback you write. And that fallback, in this case, is a list of unpersonalized rows. So I went into the system, and I navigated into my account, and you can see on the left, it says continue watching for me and my wife. And then I have popular on Netflix, which is actually a row that's personalized for me as well. And then I went in the system and I said, okay, act like there's a failure on this service for my request. And this is how we inject failure and measure it synthetically. And then I reloaded the screen, and you can't see it, but in the upper bar, the search box went away because search is no longer available. And now I'm not getting my rows, I'm getting unpersonalized rows that aren't tailored to my needs, but it's a lot better than having something that says Netflix unavailable. And so putting this in place and exercising these capabilities is something we do as part of our chaos exercises, and it makes sure that we're resilient day in and day out. In terms of improving time to detect, sometimes we'll determine that the way in which we're collecting data does not let us solve the right problem around reliability or insight. So we have a very large monitoring system. It collects data. We do have a critical pipeline from it, but in general, most data is aggregated to a 1 minute level, and it's a couple minutes delayed. There's an Edge Insight team that built an infrastructure that actually mines the data coming directly off the servers on the edge at some sampled rate, feeds it through like a top-end job, does anomaly detection, and then can fire alerts for us. So we talked to them and we said, hey, we would love to know when we have a dip in our key metric, and let us know in 30 seconds. And so this is called Mantis. If you search around, you'll probably find Netflix Mantis. There's some meetups that have occurred on it. But being able to drop that time to detect down so significantly is a game changer for us, and we're looking for ways to continue to evolve this, right? Let's get device metrics more involved now than just server-side metrics. You can tell, I showed you three slides on how we accelerate development velocity, and there are a lot more slides about how we improve availability, so sort of you'll see the summary later on. We reactively auto-scale all of our groups, of our large auto-scaling groups at Netflix. We have a predictive auto-scaling engine we developed internally where it will automatically add the number of instances required, it thinks, based on the previous day's workload, or the previous week's workload. But then we also have reactive scaling policies. So if something goes wrong, like we do a failover and we need to exceed the prediction, we'll automatically add more instances into the auto-scaling group to maintain a certain SLA. So by having this, you don't lock yourself into, you know, if you, I mean, you could do it in the cloud as well versus, as well as a data center, but when you say my service needs 100 servers to support the workload, if you don't dynamically scale with the ability to either absorb more work, either because your performance profile changes slightly, a lot of, you know, outages can be death by a few milliseconds here and there over spread over many weeks, or your workload changes dramatically, if you're locked into a fixed footprint for your service, you'll typically over-provision to be comfortable, like, oh, I think if I run a 20% extra, that's good. By auto-scaling, I don't have to think about that, right? I just say, based on the workload, maintain this RPS or the CPU utilization, and it automatically scales up and down. So that's one of our edge services in US East, and it auto-scales each day between 500 and 3,000 instances at peak. And those are really big instances. Not the biggest, but they're pretty big. I talked about having failover in place. And so as I showed you, as we had these various failures over time, we decided to put in redundancy in the United States or for the Americas. Then we moved to actually put redundancy in into EU. And so now we have this flexible capability to move traffic to all three regions. It actually lets us drive a lot of our capacity decisions. So the current thinking on the scenario, which we're going to test out, is if US West 2, say, had a failure, and for some reason we lost our traffic there, we did a bad code push, something else happened, Oregon fell off the map, hope not, even though I don't live there, Oregon's great. I would need to move the traffic to somewhere else quickly. It takes us about 35 to 40 minutes to move all the traffic to the other region. We have to do some proxying to not overwhelm the other region as we add capacity, and then we finally do the DNS switch, but it's all mostly automated. So if we move the traffic over, we have to have enough capacity in the other region to support all of the other region's traffic at peak, and West and East aren't that far apart from each other. So what we're actually going to do is when West fails, we're going to fail it to East, and we're concurrently going to take a majority of East and fail it to EU because it's off-peak there and we bought enough capacity. So you have these sorts of dials you work with. When you get to a bigger scale on the cloud, you want to think about how much capacity do I need for peak each day, and then what sort of flexibility do I want around my failover strategy? And so we're at a point now where we think there's very few things that could probably take us out. We have enough capacity, 100%. Across various places to move around. And we exercise this quite frequently, which is my next topic. So we exercise chaos quite a bit. As you know, Chaos Monkey runs every day. It's running all the time. Most people don't know about it. Sometimes they'll say, hey, did Chaos Monkey kill my thing? And you'll go look in the dashboard and see that it did. But every month, we do these chaos exercises for Kong. If you stop by our booth later, you can get one of the stickers. Kong's the big one in the back. We also have Chaos Gorilla, but Kong's the one that's really our big hammer when something goes wrong. So I don't know if you can spot the chaos in here. So we actually ran a failover exercise, and this is our global traffic over the period of a day. You can see a little blip. I don't even know if this laser pointer thing works. Yeah, there's like a little blip over here. That's not it. That's probably something else that happened. But this, those happen all the time. I keep myself up at night. This was the period during which we ran the failover between the two regions. So we've actually constructed in such a way that it's a very dynamic movement, minimal impact to users. I make sure that like, we're doing an unplanned or a planned failover exercise, I'll have my tablet out or something or sort of play around and make sure everything's smooth. Because once you start streaming, everything's pretty straightforward. So that's when we ran an exercise. If you actually took the traffic and you decomposed it top over bottom, this would be, and this is the same time window or a portion of it, US West 2, we decided to do the failover. We usually do it in the morning when we're going into peak, or we're out of peak, but heading into it a little bit. We actually do the failover exercise, takes about 40 minutes. And in that time, you can see, it's hard to see for everybody in the room, but if you look at the size of the peak on the top graph, that's what we were heading into US West 2. We did the failover in about 40 minutes. You can see the concurrent sort of jump over in US East 1. And then we ran through peak, and as you can see, the peak traffic of that evening was about twice what it was the day before. So we try to run through peak, and it gives us a bunch of opportunities to identify if something's broken, if a service somehow missed a step in the capacity deployment model, or our scripts are broken. It also lets us validate how fast we can fail over and how much buffer we need to support, right? So in our multiple availability zone model, we maintain enough buffer that if we lose one AZ, we can still support the traffic until we scale up. We can actually leverage that buffer to fail over a larger portion of the population faster, and then we have to catch up. But we really don't want to, we want to avoid overwhelming the other region. And so that's why we run this once a month. I would say maybe every three runs, we'll hit something that makes us abort it early. It's like, oh, let's scale. Oh, we hit a problem, right? And then it gives us something to fix. But every time we've used this, you know, a couple weeks ago we had an issue and we used it without hesitation. I don't even think our ECM, our more senior escalation manager, got on the call. It's like, hey, we're losing traffic in East. Traffic member just said, great, let's fail over, hit a button, and then in 40 minutes we're all in West, and then we all just went back to our weekends, right? And then we sort of dealt with it on Monday because we have the capacity. And then we fail back, and you can see it drop back off again. It's really a great exercise. The last thing we do to improve the reliability of Netflix when we're doing all these rapid changes is, this is a little less sexy than some of the other technical things, but we have this production-ready program where we try to identify operational best practices. I put some example areas down at the bottom, right? So there's 40 teams at Netflix developing 500 microservices, and they also own all of their operational behavior. And these teams might vary in size from like 4 or 5 people up to maybe 10 or 20. And everybody's on call. Every team has one person on call all time. That's why my operations team is so small. We sort of pull other people in. But if you're running your service, you have to know how to configure auto-scaling. You have to know how to set up Hystrix alerts, right? Like, how do you tune a circuit to open at the right error rate and then close back down? Your alerting strategy, right? There's a lot of different algorithms, classifiers, we have anomaly detection. Which one should you use? Canary analysis. The one I showed you is from a team that spent a lot of time to get to a point where they could do these massive pushes every day. You have to figure all that out. You have to know what metrics are important to you, and on and on. I mean, there's 10, 15 other things that people really need to be excellent at, right? And so, since my organization is in charge of improving the overall availability of Netflix, we found that the best way to do that is to improve the underlying reliability of those services that are really critical to the user experience. So we reach out, we work with the different teams, we look at all these areas, and we're actually building some capabilities in our real-time analytics framework that looks at your workload and your performance and says, these should be your auto-scaling rules, or it looks at your Hystrix circuit behavior and says, this is how you should tune your Hystrix circuits, right? Because in a company with like 1,200 engineers, there's probably, which is our company, there's probably like 5 people that can tune a Hystrix circuit well, right? It's a very small group because it's sort of a, you know, black magic. So we're trying to take all of this undifferentiated heavy lifting and make it into tooling for teams to adopt, and you'll rarely find teams that complain about giving this stuff up, right? Like when you first come and work on the cloud, you're like real excited, like, oh, I'm pushing code every day, this is really cool, auto-scaling groups. And then after a couple weeks, your manager's like, hey, what about that billing feature or that whatever feature I asked for? And it's like, oh, I'm still fighting with doing this push. So over time, we're finding that our teams are looking for ways for us through tooling to lower this operational barrier for them, right? And whenever anything goes wrong in production, the first thing I try to do is I say, you know, before doing a default of, well, that team is just not operationally excellent, I say, based on the failure that happened, what could we have done to avoid that failure, and could other teams experience that? And when we identify those gaps, then we try to figure out if we do it through tooling or through consultation. And our availability has shown that this strategy works really well. So that's our production ready program. So it works. Netflix is doing quite well. I'd like to think reliability plays a part of that, and that you push the button to play and you get what you want to watch almost all the time. So here's an example of how the various strategies fit together. There's our global SPS again, our lovely daily curve. And you can see we had a problem. But because we were distributing traffic across multiple regions, because we had a time to detect window of about 30 seconds, we detected this right away, we worked with the team, and in about 10 minutes they had rolled back that change. It only affected a small portion, well, moderate portion of that region. But the rest of the people streaming globally didn't see anything, right? And so this is the type of outage we would like to have. versus a big drop globally, which we have had before. You can go search back in February on Twitter and you'll find some interesting tweets, and we had a big problem. But our goal is to continue, the goal isn't to continue to have failures, right? The goal is to be cognizant of the fact that given we're running very fast, we're pushing code every day, we're in a very dynamic environment, there's a lot of things out of our control, and so the best we can do is we can build our systems in a way to be resilient, and our goal is to, through production ready, get rid of the failures we're having because we're shooting ourselves in the foot, and make room for those failures that we don't have control over, because those are going to happen, because we can't improve our availability if we keep shooting ourselves in the foot. So this is an example of many of these things playing out. And we've actually started to revisit how we look at availability. So we have a nines goal, like let's achieve these nines of availability. We're looking at a new dimension, which is let's also rank each outage in terms of its quality, right? The duration, the number of regions impacted, the time of day. And so if that score is increasing, that means that the outages were happening are of a better type. And sometimes it's dangerous to talk about good outages, but we want to have more good outages. When I talked about Hystrix, there's many benefits to your organization in terms of not being woken up in the middle of the night, applying something like Hystrix, where you have this insulation between various services. These fallbacks get thrown all the time. Here's an example. This is a dashboard we put together that consumes data at an hourly level, and we publish it out to the service team so they have this context. Again, there's no single team that owns the operations of Netflix, but my job is to get all the data to engineering teams so that they can make better decisions or drive the right choices. In this example, there were about 85 million requests in this hour from an upstream service to the service that I took this screenshot from. And it was only a success rate of like 99% at one point. It actually went lower than that. It got down to 96, so 4% of the requests were actually failing. You can see that it was short-circuited. So either for reasons of latency or errors, the service upstream said, I'm not talking to you anymore. And then after a while, it talked to it again. There was no incident associated with this, right? No one got woken up. It just happened all the time. I will caveat it in saying you should keep an eye on this data because it'll creep up on you. And you're like, wow, I've been throwing fallbacks for a week. Everything's cool. But the trade-off, the real benefit is you don't get woken up every time something hiccups in production. So I recommend everybody apply a dependency command type framework like that. So what about efficiency? I said I wasn't going to talk about it much, but I spent a lot of time on efficiency because it's at the top of our pyramid. It's something we don't spend a huge amount of time on, but I personally have some goals around it that I set. It is the third priority, and what we do is, as you grow your footprint, everybody's in a prod account. I can write some service that maybe doubles in size. My goal isn't to go get in that engineering team space and say, hey, you're inefficient. My goal is to look at 500 microservices across these many, many tens of thousands of instances and be very selective, just like in production ready, of who I go work with on efficiency. So you will have a trade-off in that you won't be as efficient as you always would like to be. But it all depends on where you are with your business in terms of innovation versus reliability versus cost. I think those are the three big buckets to factor how you're going to, the rate at which you're going to push code and how the flexibility you're going to give your teams. Oh, already separate talk. So wrapping this thing up, getting to the cloud is a journey, right? Many, many years of engineering effort at Netflix have gone into getting us where we are. We're very proud of it. We love sharing our open source and contributing. We consume other open source as well. But it is a journey, and so for those people who haven't jumped into it, do it in a semi-low-risk manner to start with. It's less risky today than what we did in 2008, but we would have a large monolithic application, and we would carve off a piece of functionality and say, here's our microservice. I think Andy Jassy talked about it this morning in terms of when people jump into the cloud, they tend to have new services or dev or test. If I was a startup, I would launch right into the cloud. I wouldn't even think about it. But it's going to take a while to get where you want to be. It's not just like anything. Imagine going from an application that didn't exist to getting it in the data center. It takes some time. Do as many things as you can in platform. It's interesting. I talk to a lot of people here that try to understand how we do our development model at Netflix, how we allow everybody to innovate so quickly but not be bogged down by all the machinery under the covers, all the complexity of how do we keep traffic within an availability zone? How do we understand the right communication parameters for the ELB? To whatever degree, abstract that via platform, right? Build tools, build libraries. So we do have an IPC library that everybody uses, and it keeps all of our traffic within an availability zone to other dependencies. Unless there's a problem, then it fans it out. It has all the right timeout settings, backoffs. Well, they aren't always right, but we have some. But developers, when they're developing these microservices, they don't write REST calls. They don't like consume JSON and say, oh, I'm gonna take this JSON and make an object out of it. They just get somebody's library, and in that library, someone says, make a call to this service and give me the data back, right? So I found that that's a tough area for prioritization because there might be 50 things you need to enable your teams. So that's part of the journey as well, as it took us a while to get from Asgard to Spinnaker. Break things. You know, don't break things super important, like if you're running a life support system or you're running a bank. Do it in a smart way. We're just streaming, right? So no one theoretically is gonna die if we, I can't think of the scenarios, but no one should die if we stop streaming for a little blip here and there. But once you get comfortable with breaking things and you make that part of your strategy and you're not afraid of it, you really need to break them intentionally and frequently. We have cases where people will run exercises to break the system, and we won't always learn as much as we want about the system at the time, or we might actually impact more of the user population than we plan to. So break them often, but make sure you break as small as you need to understand. Like Chaos Monkey has very little impact on our environment, and it's running all day. Chaos Kong is something where we were a little more cautious about letting that guy loose. As an organization, you know, operations engineering, we invest in reliability as a service to some degree. I had a talk last year called Reliability as a Service. You need to invest in it. One thing we found is if you wait around for all these engineering teams to figure out how to do everything perfect in production to get the availability you want, you're probably not going to get where you want to do. And it's not really fair to put all of those on all the teams and assume a very level bar. So we decided we were going to invest in improving this capability at the platform level. And I think it's a very value, it's more than paid off in terms of the rate at which we innovate and we've grown in the market. And hire top talent. You guys probably all know this, you look for great engineers. Netflix has a pretty interesting model. We also have some, we all sit in five buildings in one campus, we hire mostly senior engineering talent. All 1,200 engineers have root access to production on all the systems except for the PCI system, a little qualifier in there. But, you know, if you hire people who have familiarity with distributed systems, they understand that I'm going to write this and it could possibly break this in this way. It allows you to run quicker. And I don't think we would have gotten as far along on our journey if we didn't hire the caliber of engineer we hire at Netflix today. I know some companies will hire more senior talent and have more junior people come in and, you know, do more code reviews and get them there, but it's really nice having at least a subset of your engineering population have a deep distributed systems background. Because when you talk to people about topics, you don't want to be talking about traffic routing at an AZ and have someone ask you a question about what's traffic routing. It's nice that they know what traffic routing is. So that's my little blurb there. We had some more sessions. They had three of us. We were triple stacked today in one time slot. We have two tomorrow. One's on running Spark and Presto on the big data platform side. We're just moving. We have a data platform team that runs EMR and Presto and other clusters for general use. And then the last one is security on splitting the check on compliance and security. So Jason Chan, he's the director of our cloud security team. They've open sourced a ton of stuff. If you're trying to solve any problems on cloud security, go to the open source site and look at what they've open sourced. It's pretty awesome. Evaluations, please fill them out. I love feedback, positive or negative, and you can also email me or tweet me directly, ideally through a direct message if you really didn't like it. But I'm open to all types of heckling. Thank you and enjoy pub crawl. And we have a few minutes for questions. But thank you again for your time.